Here's a little tip. If you want to be invited to speak about something, write a book about it. And as soon as you've written a book, people will say, come and speak to us. And I want to say, why don't you read the book? Nevertheless, I'm going to do what Andrew has asked me to, and that is speak to you about the letter of Jude. And the first thing to do with this letter, as every other letter, is to read it. So let me read it to you. If you've got your Bible, you can open your Bible. It's the last book in your Bible except Revelation. It's one of the shortest letters in the New Testament, and it's one of the most important, and yet it is also one of the most neglected. So let's read it together. Jude, a servant of Jesus Christ and a brother of James, to those who've been called, who are loved by God the Father and kept by Jesus Christ, mercy, peace, and love be yours in abundance. Dear friends, although I was very eager to write to you about the salvation we share, I felt I had to write and urge you to contend for the faith that was once entrusted to the saints. For certain men whose condemnation was written about long ago have secretly slipped in among you. They are godless men who change the grace of our God into a license for immorality and deny Jesus Christ, our only sovereign and Lord. Though you already know all this, I want to remind you that the Lord delivered his people out of Egypt, but later destroyed those who did not believe. And the angels who did not keep their positions of authority, but abandoned their own home, these he has kept in darkness, bound with everlasting chains for judgment on the great day. In a similar way, Sodom and Gomorrah and the surrounding towns gave themselves up to sexual immorality and perversion. They serve as an example to those who suffer the punishment of eternal fire. In the very same way, these dreamers pollute their own bodies, reject authority, and slander celestial beings. But even the archangel Michael, or Michael, when he was disputing with the devil about the body of Moses, did not dare to bring a slanderous accusation against him, but said, "The Lord rebuke you." Yet these men speak abusively against whatever they don't understand, and what things they do understand by instinct, like unreasoning animals. These are the very things that destroy them. Woe to them! They have taken the way of Cain. They have rushed for profit into Balaam's error. They have been destroyed in Korah's rebellion. These men are blemishes at your love feasts, eating with you without the slightest qualm. Shepherds who feed only themselves. They are clouds without rain, blown along by the wind. Autumn trees without fruit and uprooted, twice dead. They are wild waves of the sea, foaming up their shame. Wandering stars for whom the blackest darkness has been reserved forever. Enoch, the seventh from Adam, prophesied about these men. See, the Lord is coming with thousands upon thousands of his holy ones to judge everyone and to convict all the ungodly of all the ungodly acts they have done in the ungodly way, and of all the harsh words ungodly sinners have spoken against him. These men are grumblers and fault finders. They follow their own evil desires. They boast about themselves and flatter others for their own advantage. But dear friends, remember what the apostles of our Lord Jesus Christ foretold. They said to you, in the last times there will be scoffers who will follow their own ungodly desires. These are the men who divide you, who follow mere natural instinct and do not have the Spirit. But you, dear friends, build yourselves up in your most holy faith and pray in the Holy Spirit. Keep yourselves in God's love as you wait for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ to bring you to eternal life. Be merciful to those who doubt. Snatch others from the fire and save them. To others show mercy mixed with fear, hating even the clothing stained by corrupted flesh. To him who is able to keep you from falling and to present you before his glorious presence without fault and with great joy, to the only God our Savior be glory, majesty, power, and authority, through Jesus Christ our Lord, before all ages, now and forevermore. Amen. Going to do an unusual thing tonight. I'm not going to give you the fruits of my study. They're in the book. I'm going to take you back into my study when I first read this little letter and first preached on it. And I'm going to share with you my thoughts as I prepared this letter for my congregation. I had not read it before. Like most Christians, I neglected it. In fact, there's hardly a verse in this little letter that anybody quotes. Did you notice that? It's all new, it's all strange to us. And some bits of it are very strange. When I first read through a book, I don't read it once like I've just read it. I read it maybe 10 times. And I have beside me always some blank paper and a pen. And I write down anything that occurs to me as I read it through and through and through. These are some of the notes I made at that time. I noticed that this writer has a habit of writing in threes, fours, fives, and sixes. Keeps repeating himself in different ways. For example, in one verse, he appeals to Cain, to Balaam, and to Korah. And three times he's appealing to somebody in the Old Testament to draw a lesson out. And then sometimes he mixes his metaphors. There's one verse where there are four different metaphors. The metaphors are about clouds, trees, waves of the sea, and stars. He obviously studied nature. And like his Lord before him, he could draw lessons from nature. But he would bring four different lessons from nature in the same verse. Then he spoke in fives and sixes. Here's a man who doesn't object to mixing his metaphors or repeating himself to make a point. The next thing I wrote down is that some of the things he quotes are not to be found in the Bible. Where in the Bible do you read about an archangel arguing with the devil about Moses' body. It's not in my Bible. So where do you get that from? And then it talks about angels being locked in dark dungeons for a very long time. Where did he get that? And then he mentions Enoch. Now, the only thing I knew about Enoch was that he went for such a long walk with God one day that God said, it's too far for you to get back home. You better come and live with me. And he walked with God and he wasn't. Lovely way to go, but not very nice for the relatives. But that's all I knew about Enoch. Did you know any more? Did you know that he was the first ever prophet to warn people about God's judgment? And he had a son called Methuselah. Strange name. It means when he dies, it will happen. Can you imagine Methuselah going to school on the first day and the teacher saying, what's your name? When I die, it will happen. That's a strange name to give a boy. And yet Enoch meant him to have that name because Enoch believed firmly that on the day his son died, the judgment of God would come. And that's exactly what happened. And it's why Methuselah lived longer than anybody else. 969 years he lived. That speaks to you of the amazing patience of God. God waited nearly 1,000 years before judging that generation. And sure enough, on the day that Methuselah, Enoch's son, died, it began to rain. And it didn't stop raining until there was a gigantic flood that wiped out a whole generation. Because Enoch's great-grandson was a man called Noah. And Noah was building an ark for years in the middle of the country, miles from any sea. And it was all due to Enoch's prophecy. And yet Enoch is not recorded in your Bible as being a prophet, and nothing of what he said is in your Bible. And yet here it is in Jude. Where did he get it from? So I made a note on my paper, I must find out where he was getting all his information from, because he wasn't getting it all from the Bible. He got some of it from the Old Testament, but not all of it. Where did he get the rest? So I write these things down. And then I noticed that there are hardly any quotable quotes in this little letter of Jude. Have you ever heard any of it quoted in the pulpit or by Christians? The only two bits I'd ever heard quoted were something from the beginning about defending the faith once delivered to the saints, and something from the end, now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, which in my day was often used as a benediction at the end of a service in church. And that bit was quoted, but nothing in between did I ever hear quoted from the pulpit. It's a strange little letter. So then having written down so many things that I needed to find out, I started asking some very basic questions. Number one, who was this guy Jude? Now, he must have been one of two things. The letters and the books of the New Testament have only come to us because their writers were prominent in the early church. Either prominent because they were one of the apostles, or prominent because they were a direct relative of Jesus. And that is the case here. He was Jesus' half-brother. For after Jesus was born, Mary had at least six other children. We know the names of the four boys she had, and we know that they had sisters, at least two. So Mary had at least six more children. after she had Jesus. And one of them was called James, and he wrote a letter in the New Testament, not far away from this one, just a few pages earlier, you'll find it, the letter of James. And this is his brother. And his proper name was Judas. So why doesn't it say the letter of Judas? Well, I think you can guess. He was not very fond of that name. That was the name of the apostle who betrayed Jesus for money. And so he shortened his name. As we shorten names, we talk about Pete for Peter and Jim for James. And so he was called Jude for Judas, and therefore didn't share the name that had become such a bad name in the public reputation. Why then didn't he say, I'm a brother of Jesus, or at least a half-brother of Jesus? Well, he must have remembered with shame how Jesus' brothers didn't believe in him and teased him and mocked him until after the resurrection. And then things happened, even to Jesus' brothers. Actually, of the 12 apostles, at least 5 were Jesus' own relatives. Did you ever realize that? Jesus had an amazing impact, first on his own family before anyone else. And that's why so many of them were at the wedding in Cana of Galilee, where Jesus did the first miracle. They were there because they were relatives, part of the larger family of Jesus. And so 5 of the apostles were his relatives, his cousins, but none of his brothers were, not until after he rose from the dead. And then with shame, they confessed that they'd been entirely wrong. But then they'd lived with him for so many years, you can understand why they didn't believe he was anything more than an older brother. But then they realized that they had been walking with the Son of God. And that so humbled them that none of them ever said they were Jesus' brothers afterwards. James didn't say it, Jude didn't say it. They simply said, both of them said, we are slaves of Jesus Christ. He bought us. Now something must have happened to those brothers for them to take such a humble attitude. So that's who wrote the letter. My next question is, who read it? And the answer is, we have no idea. There is no name of a place. There are no names of people. It's almost as if Jude was bending over backwards to keep his readers anonymous and not to make them ashamed in public, because something bad was happening among them. And so we come to the third and the most important question of all. Why did he write this letter? There must have been a big reason. And indeed he tells us. He said, I was eager to write to you about the salvation we share together. But he said, I wrote to you reluctantly because I had to change my letter. Something was happening among you that made me write a different kind of letter. Correspondence corresponds. What do I mean by that? I mean that when you read a letter, it's like listening to one side of a conversation. And you have to guess what the other side is. These wretched mobile phones. Have you sat in a train or a bus and had somebody sitting next to you speaking loudly on a mobile phone and you can't hear what the other person's saying? You have to guess what it corresponds to. And so let's say I'm on the phone on a bus and I say, hello? Has it arrived? It has. Congratulations. How much does it weigh? And what color is it? And is it petrol or diesel? Now you see, your brain has been trying to figure out what was happening at the other end. And you got it all wrong. You thought it was a baby. When I said, what color is it? Your mind went crazy. But you see, that's what you're doing when you read a letter. Something was happening at the other end. And you've got to put that together and be a bit of a detective and find out what was happening at the other end that made Jude want to write a letter reluctantly to them. And the answer is a bit disturbing. He said, there are men who've secretly wormed their way into your fellowship who are going to destroy it. They've wormed their way in without you realizing, probably coming in one by one, and they've come in with false teaching. And nothing destroys a church more quickly than people coming in with wrong teaching. Notice that they hadn't started the church, they'd come in and taken it over. That's one of the marks of false teachers, that instead of doing their own work, they try and take over other people's. Beware when that happens. But these men had come in, and they had two fundamental bad teachings. The first was about the grace of God. Can there be bad teaching about that? Yes, there can. And the second was about Jesus Christ himself. What were they teaching that was wrong? Well, the first thing they were teaching is what we call cheap grace, or even free grace, it's been called. The idea that God is so gracious in his attitude to us that it doesn't really matter what we are like, what we do, he loves us and will forgive us all our sins. It's cheap grace. I've just come back from Singapore, and I deliberately felt I should go there to challenge a false teaching about grace that is spreading through the world through the internet. It's also coming from Canada, but the main source of this false idea of grace was in Singapore. And I prayed that God would open the door for me to go and counter that teaching, which I found everywhere in South Africa, for example. And it was destroying churches. And it was teaching that grace is always there and is unconditional forgiveness. And that means that there's no need for repentance, that you can be forgiven your sins without repenting of them. It also means that the teaching is that when you come to Christ, all your future sins are forgiven, as well as your past. So Christians never need to confess sin. In spite of that verse in 1 John that says, if we sin and if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to go on forgiving us our sin. But that is said to be not for Christians by these teachers. And so here is a teaching that as soon as you're saved, it doesn't matter what you do thereafter, grace will cover your sin. It's already forgiven. There's nothing more to forgive. And therefore, you are once saved, always saved, and are absolutely sure that you're going to heaven. And so I went to Singapore when I was given the opportunity to speak about grace as undeserved favor of God, but not as unconditional forgiveness. Now that was one thing that was being taught here 2,000 years ago, that grace would cover all the sins, past, present, and future, so that nothing could separate you from God's love by the way of your sinning. That's one thing. The second thing they were teaching was that Jesus Christ is not the only Savior and Lord. Therefore, they were questioning the uniqueness of Christ. And again, that was one other subject that I concentrated on in Singapore. I concentrated on grace and the uniqueness of Christ. But we now live in a country where comparative religion is being taught in schools. And little children are being taught that there is Jesus and his religion and Muhammad and his and Confucius in his and Buddha and his. And so in this comparative religion, which compares Jesus with other people and other religious founders, people get the idea that all religions are much the same and that it's a matter of personal preference and choice. That was being taught here, that Jesus was not the only Savior and Lord. He was not unique. He was one of others, one of many. Now, these two things were deadly errors. They were cancer in the body of Christ. And cancer has a way of spreading and affecting different organs and shutting them down so that they can no longer behave as God meant them to. And false teaching of this kind is a cancer in the body of Christ, and sooner or later will destroy it. The truth is, nobody was ever able to destroy the church from the outside. When the church is opposed from outside by persecution, it grows in both quality and quantity. And as I travel around the world, I go to countries where the church is growing and getting stronger and bigger, and yet they're under great pressure. And I come back to little old England where there's no pressure on the church or very, very little, and we're dying. If you want to find a healthy church, go to a country where the church is under pressure from outside. It almost seems as if the church grows on the blood of the saints. The blood of the saints is the seed of the church. And the more opposition there is to the church from outside, the more quality Christians you get inside. And therefore, the more quantity will follow. But where there is indifference from outside, the church becomes complacent, comfortable. The devil knows that. And therefore, if he wants to destroy a church, he has to get people into the church and destroy it from the inside by questioning the faith that was once delivered to the saints. And many, many churches, even in this country, have died because of false teaching that came in and questioned the faith once delivered to the saints, which we can find in the Bible. It was written down for us. This is the whole point of studying the Bible. That is the faith once delivered to the saints, and there is no other. Indeed, Paul says, if anybody comes into your church and preaches another gospel, curse him. Let him be anathema, which means curse him. That's what Paul used to say when this happened. But let's go back to the epistle to Jude. Jude says these men who've crept in with these two major false teachings, their doom was written about long ago. And so he begins the letter by pointing to two things. Number one, the corruption they are bringing into the church. And two, the condemnation that was written against them long ago. And he appeals to those writings to prove his point that their doom is sealed. So if you have the notes I gave you, look at the page that is headed Jude. And there are two things that come out in the major section of the little letter, verses 4 to 19. First, their corruption, and secondly, their condemnation that was written long ago. But let's look at the whole letter first. When I'm studying a book of the Bible, I want to see the structure, the shape of it. And I can't get any further until I see the structure and where the writer is heading. And as I read through again and again this little letter, I learned that it's in three sections. First, the first section is all about the past. The second section is all about the present. And the third section is all about the future. A very simple shape or structure to the letter. But then these are three different parts of our existence. We all have a past, we all have a present, we all have a future. But we have a different attitude to those three. We have to, because they are different. None of us can change the past once it's happened. Even God himself cannot change the past once it's happened. He's almighty. He can do anything, but he cannot change the past. Hallelujah for that. Nobody can put Jesus back in the tomb. It's happened. It's finished. It's past. The one thing you can't do with the past is change it. But what you can do is learn from it. And that's the whole point of studying history, finding out what's already happened. That's why I've written a book about church history, because I find that most Christians have no idea where the church has been for 2,000 years. And therefore, we can't learn from their mistakes or their successes. We just don't know about it. I hope every one of you is willing to study church history. If you find that a bit too difficult and scholarly, then may I recommend you get my book. It's called Where Has the Body Been for 2,000 Years? And it's a simple account of what has happened to the church since Jesus' day. And we need to know that, because most of the mistakes we make today have been made already by the church in the past. And we can learn from them. But we can also learn from their success. When I gave those talks originally in the church at Guildford, we finished every evening by singing hymns from that era. And I found Christian hymns from every 100 years for the last 2,000 years, most of which we knew without realizing where they'd come from. And it was a real exercise in Christian devotion to sing the songs about Jesus that had been written for 2,000 years. It's so refreshing to do that instead of just learning the last 6 months of choruses, to get the riches of the devotion of Christians through centuries by singing with them is a real treat. Well, now we learn from the past, but we have to live in the present, and especially a present that has been influenced by the past. We have to live with it. We have to live with the different denominations, most of which started a long time ago. Salvation Army came out of Methodism. General Booth was a Methodist minister. And here we are in a building that has inherited his traditions and his ideas. And whatever church you belong to, unless it's very recent in origin, is inheriting traditions from the past. But you've got to live with those in the present. And there wouldn't be such deep divisions within the Church of Christ if we all knew where the divisions had come from and where we'd inherited our traditions from. So learning from the past living in the present, and for the future, we can't do anything about that except look to it. We look to the future and use our dedicated imagination to explore the future, but we're not able to change it yet until we're in it. So we have a different attitude to the past, the present, and the future, and that all comes out in this little letter. The first major part of the letter is what we can learn from the past. Then he has to tackle the problem that the situation is still with them, it's still happening, and they've got to live with it. And how are they going to cope? What should they be doing about it? And then finally, to lift their spirits, he says, look with me to the future. Lift your eyes above all this. Fix your eyes on God and what he's able to do. And get your eyes off these false teachers. If your focus is too much on human beings, then you'll get into trouble. Lift your eyes. When the outlook is bad, try the uplook. That means lifting your eyes to the God who was and who is to come. He's the God of the past, the present, and the future. And that comes out in the third section of the letter. So now let's turn to the first part of the letter, learning from the past. And I've separated his teaching about the corruption of these men from the condemnation of these men. Those we shall see, he has cleverly interwoven the two. But let's look at them separately. There are six things in the church that will be corrupted by the presence of false teachers. First of all, their creed will be corrupted. What they believe is going to change. Secondly, their conduct will be corrupted, because what we believe affects how we behave, and if we believe the wrong thing, it won't be long before we're behaving the wrong way. Thirdly, forgive my alliteration here, their cogitation. That's a word that means the way we think, the way we recognize reality. And so these men will corrupt the way we think. Fourthly, our character will be corrupted. Our character is the sum total of the way we've lived. Sow a deed and reap a habit, sow a habit and reap a character. And if things go wrong at the beginning, then our characters will be corrupted. This is how the cancer spreads in the body of Christ. It will then spread on to our conversation. The way we talk to each other will be affected. And finally, our motivation will be affected. What compels us to do what we do will be changed. Now, the cancer will spread right through these six things. They're all mentioned in the letter of Jude. One after another becomes contaminated by this false teaching. And it just goes on until it spreads, and it's death to the body. Now, he says their condemnation was written long ago. So he is going to appeal to the writings he knows from long ago. Now, there are two such writings that he can appeal to. On the one hand is Scripture, the Old Testament, what we know as the Word of God. The other is Jewish tradition, which is not necessarily all wrong or bad. And clearly, some of it Jude considers is good and true. And so in this way, the New Testament is giving attention to Jewish traditions. And we notice this, that in the five condemnations of writing from long ago, three are from the scripture and two are from tradition. Turn over the sheet to the other side. And I've analyzed the structure of this first section from verse 3 to verse 19 to show you that Jude is alternating. He alternates between their corruption and their condemnation. And that's the structure. It's an amazing structure once you realize it, once you've seen it. And then you notice something else that alternates. On the side of their condemnation, he quotes first from scripture, then from tradition, then from scripture again, then from tradition again, and finally from scripture again. This whole little letter is very carefully put together. It's astonishingly complicated in structure and yet clear. He's saying they corrupt your creed, and this is what will happen to them according to scripture. They will corrupt your conduct, and this is where this will lead to according to tradition. And he goes through the six corruptions, and each time he says, and this is what happens as the result of that corruption to the people who cause it. And therefore he's referring constantly to the judgment of God. Let's therefore go through this first section in a little more detail. The first thing to be corrupted is their creed, what they believe. And I've told you that the false beliefs of these teachers were that grace is a license for immorality. Paul had found the same thing. Shall we sin that grace may abound? It's the same problem. If you overemphasize grace, you open the door for sin. If you get grace wrong, then sin will come in. Oh, you've got outlines, good. And then the lordship of Christ is denied. Now, he appeals to scripture and God's judgment in three ways. First of all, the Exodus generation. 2.5 million people came out of Egypt. Two got into Canaan. What happened to the rest? They died in the wilderness. Why? They could have got into Canaan in less than a fortnight, having left Egypt. It was just 14 days journey to Canaan, and they could have got in. But when they got to the border, they sent spies in, 12 of them, one for each tribe. And they came back and 10 of them said, it's hopeless, we'll never get in. For one thing, there are huge walls around their cities. They're impregnable. We'll never break those walls down. And for another thing, they're all taller than we are. The Jews were little people, and the people in Canaan were big people, giants. And so 10 of the 12 spies said, we'll never get in. And the word of the Lord came and said, the Lord will carry you in on his shoulders. And on his shoulders, you look over the walls. And by his power, by shouting hallelujah, the walls can collapse. And 40 years later, they found that's what happened with Jericho. The walls were no barrier to God. And on God's shoulders, they were giants themselves. They looked down on the Canaanites. I remember riding on my dad's shoulders as a little boy, and I looked down on everybody. I was up there on his shoulders. And I was the tallest of them all. That's what they should have felt like had they gone on believing in the God who brought them out of Egypt and drowned the Egyptian army in the Red Sea. Had they not stopped believing, they'd have been in the promised land in less than 2 weeks. And yet they wandered around in the desert for 40 years. God kept them out of the promised land. And when they finally went in, there were only two that went in of those who'd originally left Egypt. And they were the two spies who said, God will see us through, God will get us in. One was Joshua. That's what happened to them. In other words, those who stopped believing had to spend 40 years wasted time in the wilderness and died before they ever saw the promised land. What a lesson. Written long ago for these people who've come in with new teaching that is not the belief they started with. And then the next was the fallen angels who came out of their estate. This is a reference to Genesis 6. Now God had made life in three layers: angels, human beings, animals. And the one thing God had forbidden was sexual intercourse between any of those three levels, whether between angels and human beings or between human beings and animals. There is clear biblical prohibition of such sex. And yet in Genesis 6, the angels came down and saw human women, had sex with them, and produced a kind of funny hybrid species, which the Bible calls Nephilim, which is usually translated giants, but we don't know. It was a species that God never intended, half men, half angels. In the same way, if you read Leviticus, you'll see that when men have sex with animals, that also is totally contrary to God's will for them. God has clearly forbidden that. But the angels broke that, and men broke it, and men are breaking it today too. And so those angels, having left their estate, we know there were 200 of them, and it was in the area around Mount Hermon that they had this illicit sex. And it was then that occultism was introduced to the human race. The angels introduced it. They had left their position and they brought the worst side of the supernatural with them. And it was from then on that the human race started dabbling in the occult. And people are still doing that today. And they are imprisoned, those angels, those 200 angels. Where did I get all this information? Not from the Bible, but from the Book of Enoch, actually, which is the source for something that comes up later. And the third example he gives of their condemnation is Sodom and Gomorrah. And they weren't the only two cities. There were four cities in the Jordan Valley, south of the Dead Sea. And they were given over to sexual immorality, as these interfering teachers were. And look what happened to Sodom and Gomorrah. They were burned up with some inflammable material in the very earth underneath them. And you know that we have records in Jewish history that the fire of Sodom and Gomorrah was still burning in Jesus' day, 2,000 years later, so that anybody living in Jerusalem could just take a 15-minute walk out into the Judean wilderness and they could look south and see the smoke of Sodom and Gomorrah in the days of our Lord. And this mentions the fire that goes on forever. Next, your conduct will be corrupted, because theirs is. They pollute their own bodies. They reject any authority outside themselves, and they slander the angels. And he counters that with an appeal to not scripture, but Jewish tradition, where the archangel Michael disputed with the devil over who should bury Moses. Moses, we know, died outside the promised land. He died within sight of it, but he died on Mount Nebo. But there is no burial mentioned, and there has never been a grave discovered. So what happened to Moses' body? The answer is an angel was sent to bury Moses, and his name was Michael, or Michael, the chief angel. And he came to bury Moses and found standing over Moses' body Satan himself. And Satan said, "This body is mine because Moses was mine." And instead of rebuking him, instead of arguing with him, the chief angel of all said, "The Lord rebuke you." He wasn't going to. He had such respect for angels and for Moses that he didn't argue with the devil. He said, "The Lord deal with you." That's the right attitude, which these false teachers didn't have. Then comes the way they thought, their cogitation. And it says, these men, notice that he says these and those, all the way through. These are the men who are infiltrating you. Those are the people in the past who did the same thing and what happened to them. Now he says, these, whatever they don't understand, they abuse. If they can't get their mind round it, they have to mock it. And that's a very common failing in human beings. That if it's something we don't understand, we abuse it. We say things against it that are silly because we don't understand. And not only that, they not only abused what they didn't understand, they did understand some things, but purely, like unreasoning animals going by instinct. What they did understand, they understood in the wrong way, by animal instinct. And so their condemnation was written in the lives of three Old Testament people, Cain, Balaam, and Korah. If you know your Old Testament, you know what they all did. They also did this rebellion against things they didn't understand. And Cain, you know what he did, and he killed his brother out of envy. The first murder in human history was motivated by envy. Balaam was the man who, for financial gain, tried to give false prophecies about God's people, and he had to be rebuked by his donkey. Incredible that an ass should humble that man and show him up as he did. I like that. I tell wives who complain to me about their husbands that the Lord can speak through asses. That usually convinces them that the Lord can speak to them through their husband, but that's another story. Korah was in rebellion against Moses. And you know what happened to him? There was an earthquake and the earth opened up and Korah fell in and the earth closed again. That was the last you saw of Korah. And he rebelled against Moses' leadership. And these men with their false teaching don't like authority. They rebel against recognized authority. Their character, they will affect the rest of the characters because they've affected their own. And we have four vivid pictures of useless character. Fleeting clouds that promise rain but never produce any. fruitless trees that look as if they're going to produce a lot of fruit and produce nothing. Rootless and fruitless, dead. Foaming waves. Have you ever stood in a harbor and watched the way the waves come in and bring a lot of debris and rubbish and foam and dirt? There's nothing so dirt as a sea of waves and foam coming in. And falling stars. When you see a falling star, it's ever so bright, and it's gone in such a short time. This is the character of these false teachers. They appear so bright for such a short time, and people follow them, and then they're gone. And so often in church history, people have followed false teachers who have disappeared so quickly. Unless they're speaking the truth, you can say that. I've often answered a query on the phone, what do I think of the latest thing from America? And I say, ask me in 2 years' time. And they never do. Because 2 years' time, nobody's talking about it. I think you know what I mean here. The latest Christian craze that crosses the pond. And suddenly everybody's talking about, and what do you think about this, and what do you think about that? And they ring me up as if I'm some sort of guru. And they ask me, what do you think about this? And I say, ask me in 2 years' time. And nobody's ever come back to ask me. If only we all would deal with things like that, instead of suddenly saying it's the latest thing and all the Christians are talking about it. But these crazes are just what they are. They're crazes, they're novelties. You stick with the faith once delivered to the saints and you'll be all right. Don't follow the latest novelty, the latest craze. Don't get a Mecca complex. Where is God moving? I must save up and buy an air ticket and go and see it. We become a kind of Mecca crazy group of Christians, wanting to go here, there, and everywhere around the world to find out where God is working. Listen, God is here. And he would work here if we believe it. We don't need to chase around the world to find God. Falling stars. And that's where he turns to Jewish tradition again and mentions Enoch and his prophecy, which is not in the Bible, unfortunately. I wish it was. Enoch prophesied against ungodly people. And that word kept coming in four times in one sentence, what the ungodly say in their ungodly way and how they behave as ungodly people. Ungodly, ungodly, ungodly. And therefore it was Enoch who gave his little boy, who was born when Enoch was 65 years old, and he gave him the name Methuselah. When it dies, when you die, it will happen. What a name to saddle on a boy. And 969 years later, Methuselah died, and on the day he died, the rain came, and a whole generation was blotted out. If only they'd listened to Enoch, Noah's great-grandfather, they'd have been ready for the flood, but nobody listened. Their conversation, you can tell people you should avoid who've come into your church and come in as grumblers, self-centered talkers, boasters, and flatterers. Those are four nasty types of conversation. And sooner or later, that will spread and the cancer will spread. One grumbler produces another grumbler. And flattery is out of place in a Christian fellowship. Christians don't flatter people. in order to benefit from them. Their conversation gives them away. And so he then turns to the condemnation scripture, and he says, if you remember what the apostles taught, you'll know that this is exactly what they said would happen. You read the apostle Paul. In one of his letters to Timothy, he says, in the last days, people will scoff. They will only listen to preachers who tickle their ears. They will go after novelty. They won't be interested in the faith once delivered to the saints. They want to know what's the latest thing. I got asked that by a lady in the street. She said, what's the latest word from God? And I said, do you want the 2-hour or the 4-hour answer? And she didn't seem to have enough time, so she left me. If you're only interested in the latest bit from God, or the latest idea, the latest craze, the latest move of God, that's what it's called now. Listen, focus on the faith once delivered to the saints. Hold on to that. There's a rock in it, and you're much more secure. The apostles warned us, scoffers will come in to the church. People who are sarcastic, people who make jokes about serious things, people who scoff at preachers. It's so easy, but the apostles told us it would happen. And it's happening here in the fellowship to which he's writing. And finally, their compulsion, their motivation. They are divisive. Their ambition is to divide the fellowship between those who follow them and those who don't. They follow their natural instincts. They do not have the Holy Spirit. And that's the final condemnation of these men who've crept in. They've come in with false teaching, with weak characters, with immoral behavior. They've come in with all this because they don't have the Spirit. And that's the last word in the first section of the letter. So now let's turn over and go back to the other two much shorter sections of the letter. And then we're finished. It's still going on. Not only in the day of the readers of this letter, but in our day, there are false teachers in the churches today and who are not willing to preach or teach the faith once delivered to the saints. In other words, the New Testament. So how do we cope with that? What do we do about it? And I find here an interesting omission from the letter of Jude. He doesn't tell them to do anything about them. He doesn't say shut them up. He doesn't say put them out. He doesn't say leave them alone. I'd have thought he would have told us, what do you do when false teachers get into your church? He didn't say go to another church. Didn't say anything. Mind you, the letter of Jude would be read aloud in the fellowship, and therefore they would be warned from the scriptures, from Jewish tradition. Enough warning had been given to them in Jude, and I wonder what those false teachers were thinking as the letter was read. I hope they'd be thoroughly ashamed of themselves. I hope that they would repent of what they'd been teaching. But my sad experience is it's not easy for people like this to repent. If they didn't repent, I hope they would leave the fellowship and get out and take their false teaching with them. But it's interesting that Jude said, I want you to be more concerned about yourselves and about the victims of these false teachers than about the false teachers themselves. Leave them to God. Let God deal with them. He will do. God has noted what they're doing, and he will not let them off. Vengeance is mine, says the Lord. I will repay. And it almost seems as if Jude is saying, leave these teachers to God. Don't you try and put the situation right. But he does say, here are some things to do for yourselves when these things are happening in the church. First of all, build yourselves up in your faith. How can we do that? By studying the scripture for ourselves, by feeding on the faith once delivered to the saints. I thank God that I've been able to help so many people in churches where they're not getting the right teaching, and where feeding on tapes and DVDs has kept their faith and built them up in the faith and edified them. The word edify is the same as the word edifice. And you build yourself up by studying the Word of God. And I thank God for the privilege of teaching the Word so that people can build themselves up in the faith, whether they're getting good teaching in the church or not. And in fact, there are even churches that would have been closed down by the authorities, but where they've been kept open by feeding the congregation on DVDs. And that's just thrilling to me. So the first concern for yourselves, build yourself up in the faith. Study the Word of God for yourself. Be sure that your faith is being built up. Whatever else is being destroyed, that's the first thing you should do. And the second thing you should do is to pray in the Spirit. Nobody can stop you from praying. Now, praying in the Spirit may be a special thing. I have the feeling it's a reference to praying in tongues, because that is especially a gift of the Spirit when you don't know how to pray yourself. When you are so perplexed and troubled by what's happening that you don't know how to express it in prayer, let the Spirit take over. Let him put the words in your mouth. Pray in the Spirit, and he will guide your lips to the right kind of prayer. You may not even know what you're praying about yourself, but it will be the right kind of prayer for God. And that's the major reason for that lovely gift of tongues. It's a gift to know how to pray when you don't know how to pray. When you just don't know what to pray for, then pray in the Spirit. That's the word here. The third thing is to submit, to keep yourself in God's love. Once again, these teachers will be leading people away from God's love, but you keep yourself in God's love. How do you do that? Well, Jesus told you how. He said, I keep my Father's commandments and I stay in his love. You keep my commandments and you'll stay in my love. That's how you keep in God's love, by being obedient and submissive to God, and obeying what he tells you to do. Don't listen to human beings and do what they tell you to do. Listen to God and do what he tells you to do. That's how you keep in God's love. I'm tempted to want to write a fourth thing there. Would you like to write it in D? After C, submission, write D, expectation. As you wait. For what? As you wait for the coming of Jesus Christ. All true Christians are eagerly waiting for Christ to reappear. He's coming back. And it's one of the major motivations of the Christian life, that he's coming back and he's going to take over. And whatever misleading false teachers there have been, the true teacher is returning. And you're waiting for him. Keep your eyes fixed on that. Now that's how we're to look after ourselves when there are false teachers around. But we also should be concerned about others, those who are being affected by that teaching. And he mentions three categories of people. First of all, those who are still wavering, who are still not sure whether to believe the new teachers or to believe the old teaching. Waverers, people who are sitting on the fence but don't know which way they're going to go. Well, we're to have a special attitude to them. They're in real mental doubt, tossed around by every wind of doctrine, says Paul. And that's the effect of false teachers. They raise doubts and people feel uncertain about it. Well, help them, love them, show mercy to them. Pay a special attention to them and seek to build them up in the faith once delivered to the saint. Do anything you can to help them. I know people in churches who've started a Bible study group in their home to help the waverers, to help them back into the truth. The second group are those who are in mortal danger. They've gone a bit further into the new teaching, and they are in mortal danger, and they should be snatched, kidnapped, seized in any way you can, and brought to their senses before it's too late. A brand plucked from the burning. And finally, there are those who've gone over to the false teacher, those who've fallen for it, and who are now sharing their immoral living. And still the word mercy comes in. We still need to be merciful to those who've fallen for it. It could have been us, but it was them. And we should have a special sympathy for them. At the same time, you can't help somebody without the fear that you could be dragged in. There's a healthy fear in Christians, and Jude puts it in a very blunt form here. You should be afraid even of contaminated underwear. That's a very direct and practical application. They are living immoral lives, and they will have contaminated even their clothes. So be fearful of contamination yourself. It's a healthy fear. Be merciful to them, but fear being contaminated yourself. Very practical advice. And finally, in this very short letter, have you been surprised at how much teaching there is in it and how much help there is in it? I certainly was when I first really studied it, but now look to the future and look to the God of the future. And we have this amazing verse, which is the verse that most Christians are more familiar with than the rest of the epistle. It's a lovely hymn of praise to God. And there are two major things about this God that we should look to. First, he is an able God. To the God who is able. Now I want you to notice the word is able. It is not the word certain. God is not certain to prevent us from falling. He is not certain to present us faultless before his throne, but he is able to if we are willing. That's the big if. There's no teaching in my New Testament that once saved, always saved. Far from it. But he is able to complete what he's begun in you. He's able to stop you falling. He's able to protect you. He's able to present you faultless. And that's the whole point of salvation, to be made perfect and presented faultless before his throne. Just to lighten things a bit, my wife is a great believer, and her faith, in a sense, is simpler than mine. I've read too much. But there's one thing I teach that my wife really doubts, brings her to the edge of unbelief. And that's when I tell her that one day her husband will be perfect. Now, for some reason, she finds this difficult to believe. She actually said to me, if I based my faith on experience, I can't believe that. But she said, I'll try and base my faith on the Word of God. God is able to do it, but that doesn't mean he will do it. We need to be willing to be made perfect. Of course, I have to believe that my wife will one day be perfect, but that's much easier for me to believe than for her to believe the other way. But that is why he saved you. He wants to make you perfect. And he will not be content with anything less than that. He is able to present you faultless before the throne of his majesty. And that's what he wants to do. That's why your salvation is not complete yet, neither is mine. I'm on the way of salvation, but I won't be fully saved until I'm perfect. Because he wants to make a brand new universe, a new heaven and a new earth, brand new. But he will only put in it people who are perfect. The last few pages of your Bible make that quite clear. Nothing unclean will be allowed in. Nothing impure, nothing imperfect will spoil that world for him or for other people or for themselves. It's a perfect place for perfect people. And salvation is being made faultless. There's both a negative and a positive here. The negative side is that he's able to prevent you from falling. But the positive side is able to present you faultless. And the ability of God to do those two things, nobody else has. It's his ability that is mentioned here. You see, not only is he able to keep you, that's only one side of the story. The other side is, keep yourselves in the love of God. There are two sides to being kept. He has one part to play and we have the other. He is able to keep, but we need to be willing to be kept. We need to go on trusting him. And you won't be kept unless you keep yourselves in his love. Now that's the truth of the whole of the New Testament. Do you know there are over 80 warnings in the New Testament against losing your salvation? Over 80. God couldn't have made it clearer. That's why Paul, towards the end of his life, says, he is able to keep that which I've committed to him. But at the same time, he says, I have kept the faith. See the two sides? They go together all the way through. Yes, none can pluck them out of his hand, but we can jump out of his hand, because those who are kept in his hand, he says, are my sheep who hear my voice and who follow me. If we go on believing, he is able to keep us from falling and present us faultless. He's able to do that. So that's his ability, and then we turn from that to his sovereignty, his authority. He is the only God. The word wise somehow crept in there. It doesn't say he's the only wise God, as if there are a lot of foolish ones. It doesn't say that. He is the only God. And to him belongs all majesty, all dominion, all power. And alongside his sovereignty is his eternity. He was, is, and always will be. Always there. Look to this God. Take your eyes off the false teaching. Take your eyes off those who are misleading and destroying the Church of Christ from the inside. Fix your eyes on him who has the ability and the authority to see you through to perfection. Amen. Do you know what that word means? It means certainly, surely, absolutely. It's not a kind of amen, question mark. It's not that at all. It's the strongest affirmative in the Greek language. And Jesus constantly used it. He would say, verily, verily, truly, truly. And what he actually said was, amen, amen. Certainly this is true. Well, we've come to the end, or have we? Not quite. Having gone through all this in preparation in my study, the last thing I do then is to retranslate the letter into my own language. And I do it by writing out the letter in black there and leaving plenty of space between, and then writing my own translation or paraphrase in red in between the lines. And then I know I've understood it. When you can translate a part of the Bible into your own language, you've understood what it means. So I'm going to finish by reading the whole thing again in my paraphrase, which is what I read to the people I taught this letter to. This letter is from Judas, though I prefer to be called Jude, one of the bought slaves of King Jesus and a brother of James, whom you all know. I am addressing all those over there who have heard and responded to the call of God our Father, enjoy the love of his family, and have so far been kept safe by your relationship with his Son Jesus. May you experience more and more of his undeserved mercy, inward peace, and loving care. My dear friends, I had fully intended to write an encouraging note about the wonderful salvation you and I share, but I now find I must send you a solemn warning and appeal to you to fight on for the old faith which was first given to the believers once and for all. I have heard that certain men, who shall be nameless, have sneaked into your fellowship. They are not in touch with God. Their sentence of doom was pronounced and recorded years ago. They distort the amazing grace of our gospel into an excuse for blatant immorality and indecent behavior. They deny that the Messiah Jesus is the only true head and Lord of all. Now I want to remind you of some facts you are already familiar with, which warn us not to trifle with God. Remember that he brought a whole nation out of slavery in Egypt, yet destroyed most of them because they would not go on trusting him. Nor were his angels any more exempt than his people when some of them deserted their proper place and function. He took them into custody and is keeping them in the lowest and darkest dungeon until their trial on the great day of judgment. Likewise, Sodom and Gomorrah glutted themselves with debauchery, hankering after forbidden pleasures, just as the angels had done. Their fate in the fire that burned for so long is a sober omen for us all. In spite of such examples from the past, these interlopers abuse their own bodies, despise the authority of the Lord, and deride the angels in glory. In contrast, when the archangel Michael argued with the devil about the disposal of Moses' body, he did not presume to condemn him for slander directly, but simply said, "The Lord is the one to reproach you." Yet these men among you don't hesitate to malign what they don't understand. The little they do understand is based on natural instinct rather than supernatural inspiration, as if they were animals without reason. Woe betide them. They walk in the same way Cain went. They plunge into Balaam's blunder for the same profit motive. Sharing the rebellious attitude of Korah, they will come to the same ruin. They think they are shepherds, but they're not interested in feeding the sheep, only themselves. They're like clouds driven away by the wind before they drop any rain. They're like uprooted trees in the autumn, with neither leaves nor fruit, dead as dead. Like crashing wild waves of the sea, casting up the foam of their shameful behavior. Like shooting stars, destined to disappear down a black hole forever. It was about such as these that Enoch, in only the seventh generation after Adam, made a prophetic announcement. Look out, the Lord is coming with hordes of angels to carry out his sentence on all the godless people for their godless deeds which they have done and all the godless words they have spoken against God himself and his godly people. These infiltrators are discontented grumblers, always complaining, pursuing their own ambitions. Full of big talk, they even use flattery to gain their ends. But you, my dear friends, need to remember the somber predictions of the apostles themselves. They said that as history enters the final stages, there will be those who are contemptuous of godliness while they pursue and practice the very opposite. The result will be splits among you, initiated by those who follow their fleshly impulses, strangers to the Holy Spirit. As for you, my dear friends, reinforce yourselves by becoming more mature in your faith, praying regularly in the way the Spirit leads you. Stay within the boundaries God lovingly set for you as you patiently wait for the return of our Lord Jesus Christ and the everlasting life he will bring in new bodies. Deal gently with those who are wavering between you and the interlopers. Do anything you can to rescue those who've already gone over to them, as you would snatch a child from a burning house. You must even feel compassion for the villains themselves. But alongside that, keep a healthy fear of being contaminated by them, even by their stained clothing. Now let's praise the one, the God who is able to keep you from slipping into all this and enable you to stand before his glorious throne, blameless and jubilant, to the only God who can save us and bring us to glory, belong radiance, majesty, all power and dominion before all time, all through history, and forevermore. Absolutely true. And finally, I'm going to sing to you, because my wife isn't here. She can't bear me singing. But when I went to New Zealand for the first time, I came across a couple called Dave and Dale Garrett, who were the first to write modern choruses based on scripture. They called it Scripture in Song. And they took the last two verses of Jude and turned them into a song, set music to them. We've tried to find the music, and we can't. Have we found it? Wonderful. Now you really know it. Now unto him who is able to keep you from falling, and present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forever. Amen. Well, good night, and thank you for listening. Come.